Hey, Dr. C with you. So why did you get thyroid disease? You know, this is a really big question that people want to know for good reason. If you can understand why something happened, you've got that much of more of an ability to help make it go away or help make it at least less apt to get worse. And if you don't have thyroid disease, or maybe you're thinking about a loved one, if you know these things, you can help cut the odds of it happening. And this is important. And it's especially important because thyroid disease is on the rise. We know this, a lot of data around this for thyroid cancers. They've roughly tripled over the last couple of decades. In fact, thyroid cancer is the most increasing type of cancer among women in North America by a lot. We also know that Hashimoto's disease is on the rise as well. It's gotten much more prevalent in these last several decades at the same time frame. And the same is also true for Graves' disease. And this is true in the United States, and it's true globally. The rates are up rather significantly. You know, case in point, we now know that just about 20% of populations can be positive for Hashimoto's antibodies. And those numbers were a fraction of that not that long ago. So in this video, I'll talk about what we know that causes thyroid disease. And I want to make a distinction. There's things that cause it, and then there's things that you can do something about. There's an old saying about how the horse is out of the barn. And what that means is that the problem has started, but the thing that caused the problem won't fix the problem. You know, closing the barn door won't pull the horse back in. And so too, many things that cause thyroid disease, either we can't change them, or even if we could, it might not help to do so. But there's some that can, and we'll really highlight on that. I'm also going to draw a distinction between causes and things that are associated with thyroid disease or things that might contribute to it. You know, the latter groups are things that, if you're already prone to it, they may make it come on a little earlier or maybe a little worse. But by themselves, they may not be all that important. And chasing them down and changing them might be what we call majoring in the minors. It might be putting a lot of work into something that wasn't really all that significant by itself. So what do we know causes thyroid disease? For starters, we've got to talk about genetics. Our best estimates are that thyroid disease is roughly 79% genetically driven. Yes, 79%. And the numbers are pretty solid for Hashimoto's, for thyroid cancer, as well as Graves. Within about a percentage point or two, they all fall right in that range. How do we know this? Well, if you're a twin and you've got thyroid disease, your twin has about a 55% chance of getting it as well. That's for identical twins. Now, if you were a fraternal twin, that goes down to 3%. So yeah, so identical genes are big factors. And yet, genes are big drivers, but they're not totally destiny. You know, our genes do what they do because of our environmental exposures and because of our nutritional status, because of our stress loads. So these things can still be important, and we can still have some control over what happens, even when genes are the big drivers. Here's a couple of interesting things about genes. So the genes that give rise to it, they do so because they control iodine metabolism. They're mostly genes that affect deiodinase enzymes, and that's how the body governs iodine's movements throughout the system. We'll talk plenty about it, but that's why genes tie in. Another big interesting point is that there's a lot of genes that totally overlap between all types of thyroid disease. And that's why if someone in the family has thyroid disease, the odds of thyroid disease are higher for other family members, but not always the same type. You know, case in point, maybe mom has thyroid cancer or did. That means that the daughter could have a higher risk of thyroid disease in general, not necessarily thyroid cancer. And we see this when a family member gets thyroid disease, others are more apt to get it, but not always the same kind. And that's because of that high degree of genetic overlap. Now, next up would be gender. And it's tough to pull this apart from genes because our biological gender is genetically determined. So yeah, we talk about the two X chromosomes that biological women have. But gender is a big factor. We know that women have 6 to 10 times the risk that men do. And there's four main reasons we know why they have more of a risk. One is their hormonal balance. There's this estrogen to androgen ratio that's higher this way for women and that way for men. And we know that when it's higher that way, that's a risk for autoimmunity in general. We also know that the changes of pregnancy can be a big driver. So during pregnancy, the body makes massive amounts of an inactivating protein called thyroid binding globulin, and that eats up thyroid hormones and shuts them down. So when that hormone, when that protein is made, and then when it's not made, the body has to do somersaults on how it's re-regulating thyroid balance. And if it's hard to do that already, that's a classic time to have it all get pushed over the edge. Then we think back to genetics about X-linked traits. So many of these genes are carried on the X chromosome. You know, women get two sets of X chromosomes. So if these genes are not as dominant, they're more apt to show up if you've got more pairs of them. And then last up also ties back to pregnancy, and this is called fetal microchimerism. That's a big, weird word. It just means that cells from the baby can sneak into the mom. And when that happens, they can look foreign and they can drive autoimmune disease, including thyroid disease especially. So gender genetics, next up is age. And this is a case to where the more time has been spent being alive, the more odds there are that certain errors can happen. Kids don't get a lot of thyroid disease. When they do, it's rather easy to manage. But each stage of life we go through, it gets more common. In fact, the peak is different for women and men. The peak age for women is about age 30 to 50. Men, it's about 40 to 65. And then the onset of perimenopause and menopause around that age, not always with the onset of the hormonal change, but around that age in life, there's roughly a five-fold uptick in the rate of autoimmune thyroid disease, especially in women. And overall, throughout a woman's lifespan, if she makes it to her 80s, she'll have about a 25% chance of developing some version of thyroid disease. So this is now the discussion about the main drivers that we can't control. You know, we can't change our genes, our biological gender, or our age. But the last big thing, this encompasses estimates are about 25% of thyroid disease onset, and that's iodine status. And we can control this. And the cool thing is that even though it interacts with the other causes that we can't control, when we change it, we've got a really high rate of reversing the whole disease. So it's kind of a weird phenomenon. You know, the thyroid needs iodine, but then why would iodine cause thyroid disease? Well, there's a little nuance here. We need some, and it's not a bad guy. We all need some. There's a certain amount that if we're way too below that, we can get thyroid disease. And there's a certain amount that if we're too far above, pretty much everyone will get thyroid disease. Now, being on the far too low side, that really doesn't happen in the modern world anymore. There were seven countries that were still considered severely iodine deficient not that long ago, but they're not any longer. And if we were to go back to 92, there was 112 countries in that category. There's none now. Individuals can get low, but getting low enough to actually cause thyroid disease, that's thought to only have happened really like half a dozen times in America since 1980, so extremely rare. Now, overt excess, that can happen. You know, a lot of iodine in medication or supplements. That's also less common. That's not the most common. The most common is amounts that are not crazy, but they're more than someone can tolerate. Let's go back to the genetics. So if you're genetically prone to not tolerate changes in iodine or slight excesses, you're more apt to get thyroid disease. We can think about this as iodine individuality or iodine intolerance. And in terms of numbers, that upper limit seems to be about 200 micrograms per day. There's many people genetically that when they get above that, they're apt to have thyroid disease start. And that ain't all that much. That's not a crazy amount. It's easy to get exposed to amounts that are that high or much higher. Now, why it does that? Well, have you ever poured peroxide on a scrape or a cut? You saw it foam and get all white? So that's oxidization occurring in real time. That foaming you saw was the generation of free radicals and free oxygen. There's three compounds we use as antiseptics because they do a really good job making free radicals. And that kills viruses and bacteria. So those big three things, we mentioned peroxide, bleach is a big one. Well, iodine's a big one also. And in the body, that generation of free radicals, that comes at a cost. So it's useful in that that's how iodine makes thyroid hormones. it binds itself onto a protein that's not easy to stick to, but the high rate of free radicals makes it more apt to stick. But the problem is that when there's a little bit too much of that, the free radicals, they hurt the thyroid, just like they kill viruses and bacteria. And by the way, when you put it on a wound, don't put it on over and over and over again, or the wound's never going to heal, because it also will kill healthy growing cells. And in the thyroid, the extra free radicals, they alert the immune system. And the immune cells get activated, they identify the causes of inflammation, and they can start attacking thyroid tissues by mistake. That's the whole idea of molecular mimicry. That's actually where that idea comes from. So we also know that in addition to iodine driving inflammation and free radical stress, it slows the thyroid and shuts it down when there's too much. So why would that happen? Well, think about when you get way too much current in your home wiring. If it's set up well, that'll trigger a fuse to blow, and that'll stop the house from burning down. It's the same way when your thyroid, when you get a lot of iodine, a fuse blows. It's called the Wolff-Chaikoff effect. And we used to think it was all or nothing, and it only applied to megadoses. Now we know that small amounts can turn it on a little bit. It's kind of like driving your car with the parking brake on. We also know that it goes on outside your thyroid. So even if you don't have a thyroid, getting too much iodine can make your body not respond to thyroid hormones. It can make you resist them and not absorb them properly across the cells. Now, the exciting thing about this is that as bad as that is, we know this is a lever that can be flipped both ways. So it can be a driver causing the disease. But if you change it and get below a certain threshold, probably below about 100 micrograms, all those bad things can go away. And in a really high percent of cases, that means the autoimmunity can heal and the thyroid can work normally again. And that's true. I'm really now talking about Hashimoto's. With Graves' disease, it's also relevant. So all the medications that work on Graves' disease, they slow iodine absorption. Now just think this through. If there's less iodine to absorb, it's going to work better. You'll need less medication. It won't take as long for it to be effective, and you'll have a higher chance of recovering. So this is exciting. This is the one big cause that we can do something about. And after the fact of doing something about, it still helps. Now, there's two more things that are pretty irrefutable causes of thyroid disease. They don't apply to as many people, but I'm going to mention them just to be complete here. Those are radiation and medication. So radiation, also a driver of free radicals and a trigger of the immune response. And we know that in the case of people who are exposed to nuclear fallout or head and neck radiation for head and neck cancers, or back in the day when you got radiation for tonsillitis, you know, those things all drive it. So these are all possible, it's all possible causes. They're just not as common amongst day-to-day people. And so too with medication. There's one called amiodarone, which is kind of a last-ditch effort for regulating erratic heart rate, rarely used. It's just full of catastrophic side effects because it's got massive amounts of iodine. And thyroid disease is one of many of its possible side effects. And also we've got lithium for bipolar disease. You know, totally got a place, but lithium is a halide like iodine, and it can disrupt thyroid metabolism. Generally, when amiodarone causes thyroid disease, the disease persists even when the medication stopped. Lithium, it usually does reverse after the medication is stopped. So yeah, but again, these are not ones that as many people take. So other factors, you may have heard that, you know, someone said Epstein-Barr causes all thyroid disease or gluten causes thyroid disease. There have been countless ideas that were all good ideas to entertain and things that have been looked at in research. We found that they're either not causal, that maybe they're associations or weak associations, but they simply aren't things that have been shown to change thyroid disease by changing them. If you do badly with gluten, you're better off avoiding gluten. If you've got a raging Epstein-Barr virus infection, you'll be healthier having it managed. But there's no data showing that doing those things will change the course of thyroid disease. And if you have thyroid disease, these aren't the most relevant things to seek out unless there's already clear signs of them for other reasons. So that's why thyroid disease happens. It's largely genetic susceptibility, gender, age, and then iodine exposure. Again, the good news here is that That last one, we can do something about, and doing so can make a big difference reversing the course of this. Specifically, studies show that somewhere around 60 to 80% of people who can closely regulate iodine can fully reverse active autoimmune thyroid disease, fully reverse without medication. And if they're on medication, they've got better chances of coming off of it. So that's the message of the thyroid reset diet. That's the message of hope that I'm happy to share. And this is Dr. C with you, and I'll talk to you again real soon. Bye-bye.